Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Today is November 12, 2017. This is the 23rd Sunday after Pentecost. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our number is 937-323-7508. Our pastor is John H. Pollock. Our choir director is Vicki Perks, and our organist is Greg Nolte.
Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to our worship service this morning. We give a special welcome to our visitors. If you're new in the Springfield, Clark County area, are looking for a new church home, we invite you to make St. John your new church home. Before we begin, one correction that needs to be made as far as our order of service goes. When you look at the bottom of the first page of your bulletin, we will have the hymn of the day, the Apostles' Creed, then the prayer of the church, and then the offering. So the offering and prayer of the church are misplaced. The prayer should be first, so those collecting the offering, please do not come up until after the prayer of the church, instead of after the Apostles' Creed. We are using the service of the word today, which begins on page 211. So I would ask that you turn to page 211 in the front of your red hymnal that you find in the pew. And I invite those who can do so without difficulty to please stand. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom our hearts are opened, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another.
Most merciful God,
we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our heart, we have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We now begin our worship with Come We That Love the Lord, hymn number 625, in the back of your worship room. Hymn number 625.
Thank you.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Therefore, encourage one another with these words. today is about the women who some had oil in lamps and some did not. We must be prepared at any time for Jesus to come to us, second coming or to come at our death. We listen to the gospel of Pastor John Pollock.
St. Matthew, the 25th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said to the disciples, "Then the kingdom of heaven will be like this. 10 bridesmaids took their lamps and went to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were foolish and 5 were wise. When the foolish took their lamps, they took no oil with them. The wise took flask of oil with their lamps. As the bridegroom was delayed, all of them became drowsy and slept. But at midnight there was a shout, 'Look, here is the bridegroom. Come out to meet him.' Then all those bridesmaids got up and trimmed their lamps. The foolish said to the wise, 'Give us some of your oil, for our lamps are going out.' But the wise replied, 'No, there will not be enough for you and for us. You had better go to the dealers and buy some for yourselves.' And while they went to buy it, the bridegroom came, and those who were ready went with him into the wedding banquet, and the door was shut. Later, the other bridesmaids came also, saying, 'Lord, Lord, open to us.' But he replied, 'Truly I tell you, I do not know you. Keep awake, therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour.'" The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. A couple of announcements to share with you this morning. First of all, the fourth base of flyers that you see in the chancel, those are in memory of Norman Powell's birthday. Also, this afternoon at 3:30, there will be set up in the gym for the YULETIDE Festival, so if you would like to come back at 3:30 and help with the set up in the gym, your help will be greatly appreciated. Also, of course, the YULETIDE begins this week with a kickoff dinner on Thursday night at 6 o'clock. Please come and bring as many people with you as you can. There will be entertainment. Also, some of the items for the live auction will be revealed at that time. And at the end, you will be able to take a tour of the gym and see the vendors who are there to purchase their items on Friday and Saturday. So please remember the kickoff supper on Thursday night. And I have been to mention that on our Thanksgiving service on the 21st, that we ask that you please bring food, non-perishable food items, to help resupply our pantry. Our pantry has been hit hard for the past several weeks. Almost all the food has been gone from the shelves, so any food that we can donate helps them out. So please, Thanksgiving service, bring non-perishable food items. Now I ask that you give your attention to our prayer.
Thank you.
at your sermon notes for today as we examine the oil crisis. Our text is our gospel lesson for today. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. It was the fall of 1973 when I entered the Hammond School of Theology to begin my seminary career. And it was also at that time that we had our first oil crisis. Thanks to Saudi Arabia not approving of our support for Israel, decided to pay us back by raising the price of oil and causing inflation to become a curse on our economy. And I can remember in the seminary when all this was announced and a bunch of us guys talking about how much more expensive it was going to be to put gas in our cars, which at that time gas was something like 35 cents a gallon or whatever, and it immediately shot up to a dollar. And I made the comment, because at this time, of course, I wouldn't be Gina, my wife, for two more years, so I was still dating the girl from college. I said, how am I supposed to be able to get back and forth to Lexington to see my girlfriend if they're going to make it so expensive I can't put gas in my car? And one of my classmates said, oh, I'm sure they're really worried about you going to see your girlfriend. And he said, we got bigger problems with this oil crisis. And of course, during the 70s and 80s, we went through several other oil crises. And depending on where you lived, it was a big problem for some areas where they had gas stations running out of gas, people in long lines trying to get gas in other areas. It wasn't quite as bad, it was just the cost of the gas and shooting the sky and so forth. Well, just as we had that physical oil crisis, there is a spiritual oil crisis. And the spiritual oil crisis is far more important and should be more of your concern than the rising price of gasoline. And that is because the spiritual oil crisis can keep you out of the kingdom of heaven. The spiritual oil crisis could find you being like the five foolish girls in our parable today, on the outside of the door and hearing the words, we don't know you, and not be let in. So, let us take a look at what Jesus is teaching us in this parable. First question is, what is the oil? The oil represents faith in Jesus Christ. You must have faith in Jesus Christ because it is faith in Jesus Christ that gives us entrance into the kingdom of heaven. There is no other way. I am the way, the truth, and the life, Jesus tells us. So we must have that faith. The wise had faith, represented by their oil and their extra oil. The five foolish girls had faith, but for some reason they let it run out. It is either because they decided the things of the world were more important, or they just decided that practicing their faith wasn't important. We're not quite sure what it is, but they're just not prepared. And so in verse 8, we read, and the foolish said to the wise, give us some of your oil, for our lamps are going out. This represents those who had the foolish idea, and you'd be surprised how many people have this foolish idea, that they can enter the kingdom of heaven on the faith of grandma, or the faith of their spouse, or the faith of their children, or their brother and sister. They don't think they have to do it. You know, a pastor was in a drugstore picking up a prescription, and when he turned around, there was a husband of one of his parishioners, and also the husband actually was a member of the church, but you never saw him. And so the pastor said something to him about, well, how come you don't come to church? How come you never go come with your wife? And the husband replied, oh, my wife goes to church for both. And so the pastor replied, "Oh, so I guess it means when you die, your wife will go to heaven with the both of them. So you can't rely on somebody else's faith to get to heaven. You have to have your own faith." And for whatever reason, and that is one thing with a parable, sometimes you cannot find an explanation for everything. You have to just look at the major point. We don't know why these five foolish gals had allowed their faith to disappear. We do not know why they allowed their faith to run out, but it did. And they weren't practicing it. And they weren't following it. And evidently wasn't important to them anymore. And so, when the bridegroom suddenly appeared, they were totally unprepared for his return. Faith is the backbone of salvation. Salvation by grace through faith. Martin Luther, describing faith, said, quote, that faith is being like glue. It glues the heart to the promises of God. That's what faith is. It's believing the promises of God. It's believing truly, without a doubt, that when Jesus died on that cross, he paid the debt of sin that you and I owe. That there is nothing we can do. We cannot bring about our own atonement. Only Christ can atone for sin. His blood washes us pure of that sin. And so, to have faith means to believe in his action. It means to believe that on that third day he bodily rose from the dead. That it wasn't a resurrection of the mind of the disciples that they suddenly became excited about his teachings or whatever and wanted people to remember Jesus through his teachings. It wasn't a resurrection of ideas. It was that Jesus bodily rose from that tomb. That it was empty. The body was gone. It was not eaten by dogs, as some heretical theologians have tried to say. It was not taken to another tomb. Jesus' body was risen. That is faith. And that is what enters us into the door of the kingdom of heaven. And then we believe that 40 days later, Jesus ascended into heaven. And that one day he will come again to judge the living and the dead. He will come in glory this time, not in humility. He won't come being as a baby placed in a manger for his first bed. The trumpet will sound, the heavens will open, the angels will descend, and then will come our Lord Jesus Christ in all his glory. That is faith. And that is what the oil represents. The five wise have it, the five wise didn't. The five wise enter into the kingdom of heaven, the five wise foolish are left on the outside. So then, why is the oil needed? The oil is needed to light our way to the kingdom of heaven. Jesus told us he was the light of the world. On Christmas Day, the gospel assigned for Christmas Day, Christmas Eve, and early Christmas morning service, of course, is Luke 2, the description of the birth of Jesus. But for the main service on Christmas Day, the gospel reading is John chapter 1. And in John chapter 1, verses 4 and 5, St. John tells us, speaking of Jesus, "In him was life, and the life was the light of people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it." He was the light of the people, his light shines in the darkness, and the world cannot overcome it. This is why the oil is needed. Because Jesus is that light that directs us to the kingdom. As the writer to the letter to the Hebrews puts it, in the 12th chapter, verse 2, speaking of Jesus, he says he is the author and perfecter of our faith. That is, he is the one who laid down our faith, laid the trail for our faith. He is the one we follow, and that we have faith in and confidence in, that he will take us into that kingdom for all eternity. So this is why faith is needed, or the oil is needed, in order to keep us on that path to the kingdom of heaven. And when we don't have that oil, when we let our faith decline, when we let the things of the world become more important than our faith, we risk that possibility of hearing Jesus say, "I don't know you," when he comes again. So we need that faith. Final judgment is a hard thing to do. For example, after a three-month recess, the Supreme Court of the United States convened on October 3rd, 1994. It began its then 1994 to 1995 term. And on the very first day, one of the nation's news services summed up the first day with the one word, no. On that very first day of the Supreme Court, they said no to 1,600 cases that had been brought before it. The names and docket numbers of those rejected appeals took 68 typewritten pages to complete. It was the final judgment. That was it. And there's something terrible about final judgment for the final word. In our system, the Supreme Court says no, and that's it. There's no appeals, no arguments. The book is sealed, and the decision is final. On that great day of judgment, there will also be a terrible crescendo of no's. No, you cannot enter into my kingdom to be heard by me. And the doors will be shut forever. There's no appeal. There's no time to change one's mind. There's no time to change one's lifestyle. Those who have rejected Jesus Christ here on earth will have forever lost their opportunity to eternal life. That is why the oil is important. That is why faith is important. Because without it, the door is closed. So where can we find this oil? Where do we find faith? Remember, oil represents faith in Christ. And for the majority of us, our faith began at our baptism, when our parents brought us to church and had us baptized, and the water and the word were united through the power of the Holy Spirit as the pastor proclaimed those words, "I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit." And with those words, God adopted you as his child, as a member of the kingdom, as a child of the Heavenly Father. The Holy Spirit planted the seed of faith in your heart, and it was a responsibility of your parents or guardians then to bring you to church so that you could learn more about the faith and their responsibility at home to teach you about our Lord Jesus Christ, to teach you the Lord's Prayer and the Ten Commandments and the Apostles' Creed. And as you continue to grow, then by being active in the life of faith, your faith is strengthened and your faith grows and your faith is nourished. Or if you were older, did not grow up in a Christian home, and were not baptized young. We are then taught the Christian faith, then baptized. The same thing happens. The same formula is given. God adopts you as his child, and you become a part of the community of faith. And so you grow with the help of the Holy Spirit and by practicing and taking full advantage of the means of grace. Now, what are the means of grace? The means of grace are ways in which God sends his grace to us in a way that we can feel it, touch it, or read it, or experience it. And there are three means of grace. The first, the most important means of grace, is God's Word. For without God's Word, we wouldn't know about the other two means of grace. We'd be totally ignorant. And so God's Word gives us the path to faith and belief in Jesus Christ. In God's Word, God reveals himself to us through his Son, Jesus Christ, as the loving Father who has sent his Son into the world, and not to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him. Through the Word, we learn that we all sin and fall short of the glory of God, and so there is no way we can earn our way into salvation because we continually sin. And just one sin separates us from fellowship with God. God's Word tells us that it was Jesus' death on the cross, that it was the shedding of his blood that enables us to have that relationship with God through faith, through repentance, through absolution. So that's the number one means of grace. The second means of grace is the sacrament of baptism, where through water and the Word, united together through the power of the Holy Spirit, as I already mentioned, God adopts you as his child, and you have entrance into the community of faith. The third means of grace is the sacrament of the altar, the Lord's Supper, Holy Communion, the Eucharist, the Lord's table, whatever is your favorite way of expressing it. There, at the table of our Lord Jesus Christ, we have that intimate relationship with him. As through the power of the Holy Spirit and faith, the bread and wine become the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. And as Jesus promised us on the night which he was betrayed, that if we eat of his body and drink of his blood, we have forgiveness and the promise of everlasting life. So these are means of grace. These are ways God shows us the grace that comes to us through faith in Jesus Christ to strengthen our faith each day as we continue our pilgrimage on earth. And then there are other ways that our faith is strengthened. By worship. By worshiping together with brothers and sisters in Christ, that strengthens our faith. Now, yes, that age-old question, do I really have to go to church to believe in Jesus? And the answer is no, you don't have to go to church to believe in Jesus. But why wouldn't you want to? If you believe in Jesus, if he's Lord of your life, why would you not want to meet with brothers and sisters in Christ who have that same confession, that same belief, that same faith, so that by interacting with each other, you learn from each other's trials and tribulations, you learn from each other's joys and successes, so that you can face the challenges as you continue your pilgrimage on earth. That is why worship is important. Also, why do you not want to gather together with the people of God and give thanks to God for the gift of his Son, Jesus? Why do you not want to give thanks to Jesus for saving you from sin, death, and the power of the devil? So worship is the way we strengthen our faith. Prayer, your own prayer life, conversation with God, one-on-one, just you and God, that strengthens your faith. As you talk with God about what's on your heart, fellowship events like our YULETIDE Festival or like Reformation Sunday when we had the dinner afterwards and watched the movie on Lutheran the Reformation. These fellowship opportunities are a way we gather together and learn more about our faith, strengthen our faith, exercise our faith, and learn from each other. When we see how someone, a brother and sister in Christ, had a difficult time and their faith pulled them through, and they share that story with you, then that helps your faith. And that helps you the next time that you're in a similar situation. And so that is where we can get the oil, where we can receive the faith. And it is that faith that is needed. If you're denying Jesus Christ and all that he did, or you have put your faith on a shelf and think that the things of the world are more important, or if you're like some people who foolishly think, well, I can put my faith on the shelf right now, I'll accomplish everything I want to do with business or my career, and then once I've succeeded, then I'll go back and take the faith down off the shelf and become involved again. You're playing a dangerous game. Because as Jesus says at the end of our parable today, we don't know when he's coming again. We don't know when he's coming again. Keep awake, therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour. As he says in another passage, the homeowner had known what time the thief was going to bring in his house and wouldn't have left. Jesus said, he will come like a thief in the night. You least expect it. So we must always be ready by having faith. We cannot be like those foolish five who let their faith run out and decide, oh, I guess it's time now to refurbish our faith, but it was too late. The bridegroom came, the door was closed, and they were not allowed entrance. So there is a spiritual oil crisis in this country. And too many people are walking around saying, oh, well, maybe tomorrow I'll seriously look into a commitment to Jesus Christ. Or, oh, maybe tomorrow I'll re-energize my faith and begin to practice it again. Part of my seminary training involved what is called CPE, a semester of CPE, clinical pastoral education. You do that in a hospital. I did mine in the old Louisville General Hospital back home in my hometown. And being the public hospital, it had the best emergency room in the whole state. It had a 1A rating or whatever kind of rating, meaning that they could even do open heart surgery in that emergency room. And so all the police runs came there, unless the person asked to go someplace else. So gunshot victims, accident victims, stabbing victims were all brought into that emergency room. That was one of my responsibilities, emergency room and medical and surgical intensive care. And one night a young fellow was brought in who'd been in a car wreck. And unfortunately, his injuries were so severe that he was not going to make it. So I sat with his mother as we watched and waited for the last breath to be exhaled. And the mother told me that although she was heartbroken to lose her son, he was only like 22, 23. She said, but that in that darkness, there was some light. Because her son had just recently started back to church. He had just recently started going back to confession. He had just recently started back going and receiving communion. And so she knew that he was dying in grace. He was dying in the grace of faith in our Lord Jesus Christ. And that gave her comfort. cannot put our faith off. We cannot put off practicing our faith. We cannot put off being active in our faith. But instead, we must make sure our oil is always full. The lamp of our life is always burning brightly, letting others know we are Christians by our love for one another and our love for the creation that God has given us. So do not be like the five foolish, but instead be like the five wise. And each day practice your faith. Each day strengthen your faith. Each day walk in your faith. So that when Jesus comes again unexpectedly, you will hear him say to you, "Well done, good and faithful servant. Enter into the place prepared for you." Amen. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, feed your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. We will now sing, "Shall We Gather to the River," in number 423, in the back of your worship.
This hymn, "Shall We Gather at the River," was written by Robert Lowry, a Baptist minister. He had a church in Brooklyn. It was a very hot day, and he was inspired with a vision of the river flowing from the throne of God in heaven. "Shall We Gather at the River," written by Robert Lowry. This is the 20th Sunday after, 23rd Sunday after Pentecost. "Shall We Gather at the River," 1864. Robert Lowry. It was a hot day in Brooklyn, and he was inspired with a vision of the heavenly throne, where we will be with cool water. We don't have to worry about being overheated, which he was in Brooklyn.
Difficulty, please stand, as with the whole church, we confess our
who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of life, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Let us pray. O God, who in wisdom did make the world and establish the heavens, we thank you for our creation, and that in love you did make us in your image, granting us the gift of intelligence and the power of reason, a house for your spirit in the temple of our bodies, and a spiritual awareness by which our hearts are restless until they rest in you. Especially we thank you for the gift of faith in the revelation of yourself and your Son, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, by whom you did commend your love towards us, and who by your grace laid down his life, tasting death for every person, that he might bring salvation to all the world. Pour out your Spirit upon us anew each day, that our love for our Lord may richly grow in divine knowledge, spiritual insight, and into a harvest of goodness and purity for your praise. Grant by your Spirit also that we may be ever kindly disposed toward one another in brotherly and sisterly love, forgiving one another, even as you have for Christ's sake forgiven us. Direct and rule your church and its fellowship in the gospel, that it may be steadfast in faith, once delivered to it, and defend it against all its enemies, that it may serve you without fear. We pray for thy blessing upon our congregation, and may your blessing be upon our upcoming YULETIDE Festival this week. Especially do we lift up to you your servants who are persecuted for your name's sake. Overshadow them with your power and fill them with your Spirit, that they, showing your glory in their faithfulness and love, may turn the hearts of their oppressors. Watch over the sick, the sorrowing, and the anxious. Be their companion in suffering and their help in tribulation. Preserve those who are in any mortal peril of body or soul, and save them by your gracious providence. Especially today we remember the families and victims of the church shooting in Texas. And Lord, on this day we thank you for our many veterans who gave of themselves so that we may continue to be free and worship you as we move. To these and all other things of which we have need, we beseech you to bestow upon us for the sake of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated.
For our offering today, this is St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. We're happy to have you watching us on YouTube. Please share this with others who will be. Let them, show them how to watch it on YouTube. Take it over to their house. Let them worship together. Let justice roll down. We need to look to Jesus Christ. Those participating in the service today, we have Nelson Linda Smith, the ushers. The reader was Steve Clark. And this is the service of the Word. We have a service of Holy Communion next week. We're honoring the Bible and the Word today. And next week, Holy Communion, when we receive Jesus Christ, we receive Him. We believe in the real presence. He has said, promised us that He would be present with us, and He will be present in the Holy Communion, and in the bread and the blood, the wine, the wafer, really His body and His blood. We're happy to have you with us. We'll be selling Meyer raffle tickets for the $750 gift card and YULETIDE Festival this week. Please bring in your extra plastic grocery bags for the kitchen. We're happy to have you with us today. And this week we have YULETIDE Festival. Next week is Thanksgiving service. So on the Tuesday before Thanksgiving, we have a light supper at 6 o'clock, and then the service is at 7:15. So we invite you to come. We invite you to help with feeding the poor. We invite you to believe in Jesus Christ, and through your belief, you're able to do all these wonderful things. He will inspire you. He will fill you with His love. He'll be with us forever. And there will be a great cloud of witness welcoming us when He comes again to us
individually as we all die, and we'll meet Jesus. And the great cloud of witnesses will be happy to see us there. We're happy to have you with us. We hope that you can listen to this in time to come to the festival, YULETIDE Festival. Thursday is a kickoff dinner, and Friday is another dinner, live auction. Saturday is breakfast with Santa. So we're happy to have you with us today, and invite you to come back anytime. 8 o'clock service, 10:30 service, Wittenberg in Columbia. Fanny Crosby. She's a blind hymn writer, an American woman who wrote many, many hymns. She wrote nearly 1,000 hymns. This hymn was inspired by one of her friends who played a melody to her in her home. And Fanny immediately said, "This hymn says to me, blessed assurance." She could get that just from the melody. Her friend was, one of her dearest friends was Phoebe Knapp. And Phoebe Knapp played this song, Blessed Assurance, 1873. And Fanny Crosby, the melody, she said, "This says to me, Blessed Assurance, we are assured that we are saved by Jesus Christ through faith."
This is my story. again, I want to thank you for watching us on YouTube, and I want to ask you to share this with other people. Not everybody knows how to work the computer, not everybody can do this service, but you can do it. Jesus is asking you to show this service to other people, be a witness to Him. Today is Sunday, November 12, 2017, and we have some beautiful flowers today. Flowers are given by Les and Cindy Pierce, and these flowers are thanks to you because they're gorgeous. And in memory of Barbara DeSellum's birthday, in honor of Becky Bishop's birthday, Linda Smith, in honor of Nelson's birthday. A lot of birthdays today. Nancy Lewis, in honor of Jennifer Ezell's birthday. Another birthday. And this is also given in honor of Norman Powell's birthday, given by Otto Winterholz. We invite you to come to our Thanksgiving service. Tuesday before Thanksgiving, dinner is at 6, the service is at 7:15. And if you're listening to this in time, come to our YULETIDE Festival. Thursday we have a dinner, Friday we have a dinner. All day Friday we have things that you can buy. And we also have the Italian dinner is November 16th, kickoff dinner is 6 to 8 p.m. Friday, November 17th, 9 to 6 p.m. Swiss steak, hamburger, live auction. Saturday, 9 to 4 p.m. breakfast with Santa, 8:30 to 10. Dinners are $10 per adult. Children 12 and under $5 only three free. Swiss steak and hamburger can be pre-ordered for carryout. Santa breakfast will be $10 for the family of four, and singles are $3 each. Thank you so much for watching us. We pray that this will be a blessing to you. We pray that God will bless you. And we're inspired by the Bible, by communion, by baptism, all these things, all these methods, means of grace that we can approach God, and He will be with us forever and ever, as He promised. Through Holy Communion, through baptism, through fellowship, through the Word, all these things. We have many choices. God is loving to us, and He wants us all to be saved.